knowing that through the beginning of this year, going through a cancer journey that he had already prepared a way that took me out of the thinking of the cancer and in focusing on being able to teach. And in doing this teaching, not only is it a faith buildup for me to lift me up during those times, it's also been a teaching time of seeing his presence in a way that I had not even seen before with all of my knowledge and everything. It's like, oh my gosh, wow, wow. So a lot of what I've been sharing with you guys is also, it's inspiring and it's teaching me. And I was talking with Brother Butch. He's going to be taking back over next week with the Unit 2 of our lesson. But it was a blessing for him also, because over the last 6-7 weeks, he really needed to focus on his own eyes as well as giving his attention for his wife. And now, you know, we see the fruit of that, that his eyes are doing much better. Debbie has made it through some very life-threatening issues, you know, praise the Lord in a miraculous way that we can just say thank you. So God works with the body, of helping the body to work together for a bigger picture. You know, 2 months ago, like I said, I was working through a journey of surgeries and treatments for cancer, and now I'm saying, I don't have cancer, and I'm done with all my treatments. Butch was dealing with his eye situation as well as his wife's situation, and now he's getting ready to say, look what the Lord has done. So it's the body coming together, and that's what we want to be. The big picture here is that as we pray for one another, as we lift one another up, that the prayers are being heard, and that the way this lesson was strategically placed before any of us even knew about it was giving me an opportunity to bring a woman's aspect of a faith walk that maybe from a masculine side wasn't even considered, in order to bring us into a new understanding of a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Today is Palm Sunday. If you're not aware of that, next week is Easter. Palm Sunday is all about the triumphal entry that Jesus took after he raised Lazarus from the dead, and now he's triumphantly coming into Jerusalem, and they're all doing the palm branches of hailing him as king, which is like, what? What's going on? If you didn't know why he is being hailed as king, it's because he raised Lazarus from the dead. That's what we have to understand. If we don't get the fact that Lazarus was raised from the dead, then we still have a Sunday coming. If we don't realize that the cross is finished and that we are today new creations in Christ, that we are on the other side of the cross in Christ, then we're still looking for the return of the Lord. We're constantly doing that. And we're going to function in that. Well, today's lesson, we're finishing up about three women. We're on lesson 7. Just to recap the women that we've already covered. We covered Rebecca the first time. This whole book that you're dealing with is about a relationship with the Holy Spirit. It is not a book about being saved. It's talking to Christians. So that you've already had a salvation message, but then what? And this is going to be the challenge after Easter, is that a lot of people after Easter are going to go back into a complacency with their relationship with Jesus and look for Christmas to get that zeal of, okay, we got to get stirred up in the Spirit. No, what happened after the cross? What happened after the resurrection? That's what this is all about. It was about the Holy Spirit. So what we have with Rebecca is showing us that it is because of the resurrection we are new creations in Christ, and that we are married to the Lamb of God. We are a bride in preparation. We just simply have not coveted the marriage in consummation. That's what we're waiting for. But we have the legal name, the legal title, the legal authority because of the resurrection. We just have to work it out. If you don't know that, and you're staying as a child of a Sunday coming, what's happening is church is preaching John's gospel, prepare ye the way, and a water baptism. Jesus did not do a water baptism. He did the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire.
Oh, yes.
That's laying on of hands. That's the Holy Spirit in me, that when I lay hands, that is the baptism. And the big hang-up that we have here is every time we see the word baptism in Scripture of the apostles baptizing, we want to make it a baptism of water. The baptism of water was about John. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That was John's message. That was not Jesus' message. John said, that's Matthew 3:3. John said, somebody's coming after me that's going to do the greater works. He's coming with the Holy Spirit and fire, and he's going to baptize you in that. So when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are being baptized with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
But if you don't know that, and you think, okay, that baptism is just going into the water and coming out, and now you're trying to figure yourself out, what you have is you have, I know Christ is in me, but my challenge is me getting into Christ. You getting into Christ is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And the fire is the fire burning off your flesh. That's what these three women are all about. Rebecca is the one that says, you're married to the Lamb right now. Then we had Rahab. Remember Rahab the prostitute? But she was more than that, because she remembered the promise. She was a woman of faith that remembered the promise of 40 years earlier of what happened with Egypt and the Red Sea. And she was living off that promise despite the fact that her family was in town. She was on the wall watching. She was looking. And because of her faith, not her ancestry's faith, she saved her and her household. That's huge. It's because of your faith, because the Holy Spirit is in you. You have the authority to save you and your household by faith.
Oh,
and
yeah.
God will honor
that
faith.
Yes.
But if you don't believe it, and you have to see it to believe it, then
you don't have the faith.
You don't have the faith. We had Ruth. Ruth is the illustration of the redemptive power of Christ in you. But it's more than just the redemptive. It's the reconciliation. It's that all things are now new. But if you're still living after that old man, if you're still remembering your past, if you're remembering all those negativity things from the past, and you're holding that, holding yourself hostage of that, you're not living a life of redemptiveness. And if you don't live a life of redemptiveness and realize that your past is only a platform to take you into a reconciliation of the kingdom, and it's woe is me, I'm never that good, I'm always doing this, I'm always doing that, you're stuck in what Paul talked about in Romans 7, that says, I want to do the good things, but I can't do the good things, and the things that I want to do, I can't. I'm just struggling with that. And you're not pulling yourself into, but now, in Christ, there is no condemnation. Stop condemning yourself. Because if you're condemning yourself, then you're also going to use that same condemnation to judge somebody else out there.
So you're actually saying, God, I don't believe you.
There you go. That's what Ruth is telling us. Now we have Esther. A lot of y'all didn't even know Esther was in the book. Esther is our illustration that says that, remember that I had said in the book of Esther, the name of God is not mentioned. You have to know who you are in Christ. Esther was the queen. So when you know that you're coming in the authority, that Jesus Christ is king, and that you are married to the king, that makes you a queen. That makes you the body, and that gives you the rights that and the authority for a kingdom. You're not royalty. unless you've got land territory. That's your rights. It's a people, it's a land, it's a nation, it's a custom. So that what she had to do is realize, okay, she's Queen Esther, but now it's not about her, it's about a people. And if she's, if the people die, she's going to die too. If Mascot and Groen get burned up and, excuse me, go to hell, guess what? You will too. Because you had rights to take authority, and God's going to hold you accountable.
Yep.
If your family, and all you see in your family is, well, they're going to go to hell. They're going to, you know, because of this, this, and this, your faith isn't strong enough for your family. And God's going to hold you responsible because he gave you the faith to stand in the gap. That's what Queen Esther represents for us. And despite the difference of what we see with our natural eyes, if our eyes are focused more on what we see in the Holy Spirit and through the spirit realm, and we speak that into existence now, by faith, God will bring it to pass.
Amen.
It's not about our timing, it's about his timing. So we've got to change our attitudes if we're going to start changing the world. Mary Magdalene. Love Mary Magdalene. Like I said a couple weeks ago, she is the first apostle. She gets a bad rap of the demonic realm as well as the prostitute concept. But she is the first apostle because if we didn't have the woman's voice, from what she not only heard but also saw, we would not have Easter services today. All the men scattered. John had to be told by Mary to go to the tomb. John, even though John was there at the cross, he was not there at the tomb until after Mary spoke. So we've got to rethink in terms of bringing the woman aspect of what was Mary's real relationship with Jesus. She loved Jesus, but not as the way a man and woman loves here. She loved him because she recognized her own soul and spirit of the true treasures that were in her. And she wanted part of that body. She wanted part of that kind of a relationship. So that she didn't have to go to the Galilee and see him as he had told the other apostles. When you see the Holy Spirit right here, many of you have heard the Holy Spirit, but God wants you to see. What does seeing the Holy Spirit look like? What does Spirit look like? It's called familiar Spirit, or it's called the unconditional love Spirit. The love, the life, and the light of God.
Love, and love, love.
When you're in God, there is no fear. That's what Mary was experiencing. And when she went to the apostles, she said, I have seen the Lord. Many of us are still looking for the Lord to return and come again. He came again. And he keeps on coming. He's not coming as a man from Galilee, though. He's coming as the resurrection. He's coming as Christ in you. We need to get ourselves in Christ. Then we had the woman at the well. Before the cross, the woman at the well, she is baptized with living water. It's not our typical baptism. It's not, okay, we're going to bring you down and bring you up. She had the baptism of John because the living water is right there. And not only did the living water bring the transformation of repentance into a salvation, but it also equipped her with the Spirit that she was able to go through and change a whole. And she goes up to Asia Minor before the ministry of Paul. So I say that as we get into now, a lot of what Paul talks about, what happened with Paul in Acts, and we're in lesson 7, we've got three ladies here. Timothy. Timothy is, has been raised by his grandmother and his mother. This is our faith message for your family. That you are here because you probably have somebody in your family, and it can go all the way back to Abraham. If you don't know any grandparents or parents or distant relatives, guess what? Father Abraham's been praying for you because he's standing in the gap of what the promises of all people. And by him, over 3,000 years ago, you're here today. So maybe you don't know a personal relationship, but Father Abraham knows you. And it's his faith. We find that out in Hebrews 11. By their faith, even though they hadn't seen it yet, their faith stood in the gap for each of us. You have that same kind of faith right now.
So they without us could not be made perfect.
So that's what Timothy's mother helps us to represent. That she, we don't know a whole lot about her, but we do know that Timothy had a mixed family line. He wasn't totally Jewish because of his father. But his mother's faith and his grandmother's faith was an evidence that there's a historicalness that Paul was going to come along and bring the fatherly side that Timothy needed to equip him and to encourage him. But the seeds had already been planted there. So we've got Eunice of New Testament. Then we have Lydia. Lydia is a beautiful creation. I've traveled all of the footsteps of Paul throughout Asia Minor. So I've actually been to Philippi in the grounds, and I started to bring a picture, but I left it at home, of me standing next in the waters where Paul is having this encounter with the same river. This river, you couldn't do a water immersion in. It's more like what we have of creeks. Maybe in North Carolina, that the river's only about this deep. It's only about a foot deep. It's rushing. It's filled with rocks. You might do some sprinkling if we're going to water baptize, but you're not going to get a full immersion unless they just had a major storm and the rivers had risen or something like that, and then the waters would have been too rushy that you probably wouldn't want to get into it. The baptism of Lydia had already known about the Lord. Her baptism is of the Holy Spirit. That was the baptism that changed. Unfortunately, the way the scriptures are being interpreted, we don't recognize we're just using the word baptism as water baptism. The water baptism isn't what she needed. It was the Holy Spirit of what she needed. Just as what each of us need. That's what equipped us. So we can learn the fact that there's a baptism of the Holy Spirit that Paul was able to impart on these women. Another issue with Paul's story with Lydia is that she's a woman that sells purple. Purple dye is an anointing of mercy as well as an anointing of kingship. So she had treasures within her that just needed to be taken into a spiritual realm, that the anointing of the Holy Spirit was raising her up into the royalty of who she was so that she could give that away, as well as it being led by mercy and grace. That's what we each have. That's a gift that the Holy Spirit was already there in her. She just needed to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and you do that by laying on of hands. You impart that onto people because it's already in you. Another area about the story with Lydia that we find out is that they're meeting at the river. They're not meeting. There was no synagogue at that time. The synagogue came later. That should tell us that the church itself, the initial church, was not about brick and mortar. It was not this. It was this. You are the church. We need to reestablish who is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not the Baptist down the street. not the Methodist, it's not the Church of God of Prophecy, it's not the Lutheran, it's not the Catholics. We're all one body with many members. And you can meet people where they're at. The story of Lydia tells us that on your dailiness, while you're at work, whether you're playing golf, whether you're at the hospital, whether you're at Publix,
anywhere,
should be an opportunity of ministry. You should be there because you and God are together, and you should be asking Him, say, okay, what are we doing here? Why did you take me this route? What are we going to do? What do you want me to see? I know I'm buying some groceries, but I'm at this grocery store at this particular time, at this particular day. Who else is here that you want me to not focus so much about the groceries? The groceries are going to get bought. But who do you want me to see here? Who do you want me to go say hello to? Who do you want me to by faith come across their path? And sometimes it might be that they're actually going to have a literal conversation, but sometimes it may be that, no, all of a sudden the Lord's showing you a woman with some kids or something over in another, over there, and she's stressed out. And she's not there to tell you her problems or anything, but you can speak peace upon her. You have that authority. Because you can identify with what she's dealing with. Or you might see somebody else walking around with a cane. Or you might see somebody else, you know, that just seems kind of lost or confused, trying to figure something out. That's a spirit of confusion. That's a spirit of oppression. That's a spirit of maybe a rejection. In the Holy Spirit, you can identify the familiar spirits that are holding hostage the body of Christ. And you can speak life into them. But you have to know your name, your nature, your identity, and who you are married to.
You were talking about that. My son wanted me to take, I didn't feel like it at all, but my son quickly, he wanted me to take it to Walmart, and I didn't feel good at all, so I sat on the bench up there, and this lady came, and she sat on the bench, and somehow I knew she was hurting. She said, how are you? And I said, I'm hurting. She said, I am too. And so I said, let's hold hands and pray. So go ahead.
Well, Judy was telling me this morning that the Lord woke her up early this morning with a migraine, but instantly it was not about her having a migraine, that she knew in the spirit that somebody out there was dealing with a migraine. And so she shifted the conversation instead of, oh gosh, I got this migraine going on and I want to sleep. She shifted it into, help me to pray for this person that's got a migraine out there. I don't know who that person is, but she warned during her sleep time, which God was waking her up to hear, because she is the light of the world.
Amen.
The challenge with migraines is that in order to get relief from a migraine, you go into darkness.
Yeah.
That light bothers migraine. I mean, people with migraines, it's like light bothers them.
Yes.
But if you are the light of the world, you're going to get in there and you're going to pull them out of darkness. And that's what she did. She wore during the night for somebody. She has no clue who it was. But the obedience of, okay, there's a body out there. There's somebody out there that's got a migraine. You know, I'm sure she probably kind of kept asking the Lord, does she know this person? But whether or not you know them, the fact that it's there helps you to discern and say, I know this migraine, you know, is not about me. That's part of what you have to discern about your own body. Lord, is there something going on in my body that I need to direct attention to? And if it's like, no, nothing happened, then you say, okay, it must be about somebody else. Do you want to give me that person's name? Or is it just send it out? We don't know how many migraines she was praying over. It may have been a half a dozen or something people that had migraines. The fact that she wasn't given a name. And then you need to rest, because when your cup has been empty out, just like the Lord had to go off on his own, you need to be able to replenish yourself. But to replenishing yourself with the Spirit of the Lord coming back. These are the kind of things, as we move and we're having our functioning, we are at a place that to say, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. He's saying, this is that. What was prophesied in the past is now come to pass. That in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This salvation is not John's salvation of repentance. It's the salvation that you are healed, delivered, and saved. You are a whole new creature. It's not just repentance from works of John. It is you are filled with the Holy Spirit before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. We keep wanting to make that into a someday. The someday was back with Joel. Peter is saying, this is that. This is the someday. You've got the anointing. You've got everything you need right now.
Amen.
The treasures are yours.
Yep.
Grab them, take hold, and make a difference in this world today.
Oh, yeah.
That's what we're missing so much of. The last woman that we have is Priscilla. Priscilla and Aquila were part of Paul's ministry that he was in Corinth. And then he went to Ephesus, and he left them in Ephesus. But what he saw with the two of them was not subservient to what he was teaching. It was on the same level. In the church community, Aquila and Priscilla, both husband and wife, were walking in an anointing as apostles, helping Paul. They were part of the apostolic anointing. They came, and when they got to Ephesus, Paul left them there. He had enough recognition that you're good, you're on your own, you don't need me, I can go back to Jerusalem. And they meet a man called Apollo. Apollo came from Alexandrite down in Africa, and he had the anointing of the baptism of John. We find this in Acts 18. So he's preaching a mighty, mighty message that today would sound very similar to, if you were raised Southern Baptist, it would sound very similar to a Southern Baptist message. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That was Apollo's message. Aquila and Priscilla come to him and says, you know, you got it. That's good. However, let's give you the bigger picture. And they baptized him with the Holy Spirit because they asked him, what kind of baptism have you had? And he said, I only know the baptism of John. Let's baptize you with the Holy Spirit. That's our message today. We need to get out here and baptize people with the Holy Spirit.
Oh, yeah.
And the Holy Spirit, when we go to what Paul talked about in 1 Corinthians 13, it's one of our famous verses we love to read and love to have at weddings. Now I'm going back to Rebecca. What is love? What does love look like? Love is patience. Love is kind.
The before there was Bobby.
Yeah. It's, let me see if I can, I think I wrote it down here. Yeah. But here's some key factors is that sometimes we have this love as, ooh, this feels so good. This is great. Oh, I just love you. You're just the kind of thing. And we don't realize it has an identity. So if we change where we say in 1 Corinthians 13:4, love is patient and kind. Let's say Christ in you is patient and kind. Christ in you is not jealous or conceited or proud. Christ in you is not ill-mannered or selfish. trusting you never gives up. It's always faith, always has hope, and always has patience. And it is always eternity now. It's not someday. It's a now presence. I'm going to pick on Frank and Linda back here for a second. Frank, you and Linda sitting across the table from each other. I already picked on these two, so I'm going to pick on these two. And Linda's in a state that says, oh, I just can't wait till Frank comes home. Oh, I just miss him so much. I just think about him all the time. And Frank is here saying, hello, Linda. Hello, Linda. You know, I'm right here. And she's looking right in you. She's looking right at your eyes. And it's like there's this blankness. You know what? You know what's happening there? Your spirit's grieving. Because you're wondering if she's dementia. You're wondering if she's losing something. We've had that kind of experience with our moms, our dads, with people, dementia, Alzheimer's. And it grieves our spirit. It grieves our spirit when our mom and dad don't recognize us anymore. And yet we're sitting there and says, Mom, this is me. Linda, this is me. I'm right here. This is Frank that loves you. We're doing that to the Holy Spirit constantly, every single day. Because he's right here. And he wants to impart that love of Christ in you and through you. But not only to equip you, but so that then you can be the blessing of taking dominion and authority over the whole earth. So that you can speak life into a darkened area of the world that needs to see the Savior today.
That's the greatest tool, isn't it?
It really is. So this woman aspect is not a gender issue. It's about your relationship with Jesus Christ, whether you're a male or a female. And do you have that relationship as a love relationship because of what Jesus did? Or are you still waiting for him to come and do something? And he's saying, I already finished it. I finished everything on the cross. And I pray the Holy Spirit in you. Let the fire burn. Let the fire on you burn. And if you know, if you don't feel like you have the Holy Spirit's anointing, that's what we do every Sunday, standing up here. People are coming up here, and they're asking for prayer.
Amen.
For some, it's a healing.
Amen.
But what we're doing is we're praying, and we're imparting the Spirit because of Tommy's hands, my hands, and everybody else's hands that are up here praying with it. We don't have it of our own. But the Spirit in us is allowed to anoint that whatever's causing you oppression, whatever's causing you pain, whatever's causing the sufferings, whether it's mentally, physically, emotionally, or just familiarness, the Holy Spirit in us is saying love is going to be the answer. And the dunamis power of that love and grace is going to wipe everything out.
Amen.
Whether you believe it or not, we believe.
Yep. Amen.
That's what we're, the strategy as we move from this song, this Palm Sunday of the hailing the King into Jerusalem. Is he your King? Is he your resurrection life that's in you today? So that next week when we talk about the cross and the resurrection, we know that as he is, we hung on that cross with him. But because we hung on that cross with him, we are also raised with him today. And we are seated today in heavenly places to rule and reign and take dominion back that the enemy has stolen on this earth.
Amen.
Let me close this in prayer. Father, I just thank you for this